graduates researching into diagnostic imaging or electronic and structural material engineering. At Radley, there may not be any aerobic dancing or cucumber face packs, but the school grounds do offer other forms of relaxation.
Great shot, Rory.
I mean, the weather's not perfect today, but it's not a bad way to relax 4 days before the main event.
No, at all. And I think the beauty of the Oxford, we have some multinational side, you see, and we're able to get the groups together, and we're very pleased to have you in our squad as well.
Some national teams, here I am, making up the numbers.
Indeed, you're doing us proud at the moment.
Of course, on Tuesday, Twickenham is another sellout. It's one of those great social gatherings, but I know that you're concerned about the rugby standing up for itself now.
Oh, yeah, I think the 70s showed a decline in varsity rugby. And both universities, I think, have done their best to look at what they can serve the game. And I think by the recruitment that's gone on, despite the controversies, I think the quality of rugby served up in the varsity game is certainly of the highest standard in the last 4 or 5 years.
Well, that's me and my playing days put in perspective. Still, back to the main event.
Two Welshmen and two people who are new to the Varsity Match, Steve Barclay and Andy Moore. Not entirely new for you, Steve.
No, I was on the bench last year. It's a great occasion, but I got the atmosphere, so I know what it's going to be like next Tuesday.
The pace of the Varsity Match is always the thing everybody talks about, Andy. The Stanley's game was fast, but...
But the first 20 minutes of the Stanley's game was, I thought, played a ridiculous pace. But Mark Egan, the captain, told us after that compared to the first 20 minutes of the Varsity Match, it was almost snail's pace. So something to look out for.
You're in quite an unusual position. You're playing against Andrew Booth of Cambridge, but of course your clubmate's back at Cardiff.
Who? Yes, it should be interesting duel. I've played against him quite a few times now and very much looking forward to it.
I've seen him play better than that.
Yeah, a bit of pressure with the cameras around, I think, and the wrong choice of club.
I'm sure on Tuesday your troops will see a Mark Egan they know better, but the whole build-up from Oxford, I mean, it tends to be a bit eccentric, doesn't it? In comparison to Cambridge, they've put together four straight wins in their build-up. You did it the other way around.
Yeah, we got off to a very good start. We had a good pre-season tour. We went to the Far East, won all our games. Then when we came back, we won our first four games. Hit a bad patch then for about five games where we lost to teams like Leicester, Cardiff, Wasps, Northampton. Mind you, we lost quite narrowly. We played some good rugby during that period, but we were unlucky, I think, to lose some of those games. Then we bounced back with two wins in the last 2 weeks there against Scottish Students and London Welsh. We got a very big front row with Andy Everett, who's South African boys played for Western Province, and Hayashi, who's one of the most capped Japanese internationals. So there's a lot of experience there, and I think they could cause Cambridge some trouble.
They're causing the greenkeeper a few problems as well.
Yeah, there's a few divots being hacked up around the place, but he'll have no problem replacing them, I don't think.
Top of the leaderboard, England A, 2 under par after 7. On the 8th tee, Will Stileman. Any high handicap, counterbalanced by a little local knowledge.
Yes, I taught here for 2 years after coming down from Cambridge before I went up to Oxford to Wycliffe Hall, trained to be a minister in the Church of England. But I think Jesus Christ has a place in all walks of life, be it rugby or anything else.
Perfect. Final result of the Oxford University Desert Classic at Royal St Radley, England A fending off the Celtic Fringes, Ireland and Wales. In fourth place, South Africa. England's victory was made easier by the withdrawal of the Pacific team, containing Gary Hine of California and Toshiyuki Maru Hayashi of Japan. Maru, we saw you arrive at the golf club, but uh-huh. we did not see you finish.
Uh-huh. Yeah, because it's too cold, so I'm freezing, so I was given up.
After how many holes?
Only 4 holes.
Were you playing well?
Not bad, yeah.
Now, Tuesday is your first varsity match.
Yes.
But you have played a lot of international rugby at home in Japan.
Uh-huh.
How many times have you played?
I have 31 caps.
Now, those caps will have been won in the position of second row?
Yes, most of them in second row, and I sometimes play flanker.
But on Tuesday, you have to move up to prop.
Yeah.
Is it? Has that been a big change for you?
Yeah, it's a big change, actually, because in Japan, I'm quite big and tall, so I play second row. But I'm not so tall enough in this country, so I have to move my position.
The air shots and misty slices will soon fade before Tuesday's great occasion. The Varsity Match, as ever, will be a torrid affair, the winner desperately difficult to predict. Anyone foolish enough to wager strongly on either side will be skating on thin ice.
And we'll be back with Rugby Special at the same time next week. Varsity Match as the mangiest of underdogs. No fly half, no line out, no goal kicker, no chance.
It's been riven by Inter for the 109th Varsity Match. Oxford, of course, have been riven by internal strife early on in the season, which meant the departure of their Australian internationals, Brian Smith, who will be running the line on the Oxford side this afternoon, and Troy Coker in the second row.
I paid my dues time after time. I've done my sentence but committed no crime. And bad mistakes I've made a few.
Penalty as it collapses.
I've had my shells and kicks in my face, but I've come through. And I need to go on, 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 on. Me, I'm a champion, my friend. And we'll keep on fighting till the end. We are the champions. We are the champions. Yes, we are the champions.
Of the world. Superb build-up play by Cambridge. It looked as though it was the Oxford line that was threatened, but then with a bit of brilliant anticipation.
I've taken my bows, my curtain calls. You brought me fame and fortune and everything that goes with it. I thank you all, but it's been no bed of roses, no pleasure cruise. I consider it a challenge before the whole human race.
Well, I don't think it's a case of vindicating anything. Someone did say in the papers that the scoreboard will say who was right and who was wrong. Oxford won. It was a team effort. We played together. And it's just a wonderful, wonderful feeling. And I think we deserved our victory.
And of the this is your third, isn't it?
Third,
is this the best?
It's the best feeling, definitely. 88 was superb. We played wonderfully and won well. But this is the best feeling, yeah. Definitely.
Now, with us, we've just got the other try scorer, Andy Moore. Many, many congratulations. Now, this is your score. What do you remember about that?
Not a lot. I just remember Jan kicking up the field and chasing on. And the next thing I saw was about 60 yards and no one in front of me. I was worrying here about my footballing skills. I think I had to kick. Did I have to kick my right or left foot?
Three
with the left foot again.
What a marvelous feeling that must have been.
I was thinking about last year when Adrian Davis had popped up to him, and I was just hoping the same would happen. I think I have a bit of an epo there, go wild.
And also, just to have your good friend and rival close on your back there too, that must have been even better.
It was nice just to beat him to the touch. I really enjoyed the game. I think Andy did as well. I think it's disappointing that someone's going to lose on the day. It's such a great occasion. But at the end of the day, I think it was a good game and everyone enjoyed it.
Well, the stage when it could have gone either way and it just happened to go our way. I feel so sorry for Cambridge. It's a terrible pity that someone has to lose on a day like this, but that's the way it is.
And your forwards really were putting in a marvellous performance to tie up the Cambridge back.
Will Stallman, Andy Everett, Glenn Taylor, the lot of them, they were just wonderful, they really were.
Well, many congratulations. Off you go now and enjoy your success. Congratulations to you both, congratulations to Oxford. And let's now have a final word from our match commentators, Hugo McNeil and Nigel Starmer-Smith.
Well, it really was a fantastic contest. All credit to Oxford. I'm sure Cambridge must be very disappointed. They looked so polished, they just couldn't quite get away on a number of occasions. It was so close. But full credit to Oxford, full credit for the spirit with which they played, and they'll certainly be celebrating that victory today.
Well, team spirit counts for everything. The underdogs have had their day again, and the glorious uncertainties of the Varsity match are to the fore once again to revel in, and I'm sure Phil Twickenham, just as it was today, to capacity in 1991.
So the final stages of the Bowring Bowl, the Oxford, the holders now of the Bowring Bowl, and have reversed the trend, Cambridge the winners for the last couple of years. So it's been a magnificent afternoon, I think one of the closest matches that we've seen for many, many years, and Oxford very much deserving their victory. So it's been a marvellous afternoon. We'll be back next week with the rugby special on Sunday, that's the next rugby, but from all of us here at Twickenham, a very good afternoon to you.